I've talked about some of the technical background to the use of spectral methods overall. Now, this is all very pretty mathematics, but we're involved with a computer science course. So, what I'm going to be doing in the next two lectures is to give some background on why we are studying spectral techniques as part of a computer science course. So, I'm going to start off by looking at one of the classical applications in computer science, and that's in a topic called algorithmic graph theory. So, just to give some background, graphs and networks are a very widely used modeling form, not only in computer science, but in many other physical sciences as well. So, for example, traditionally, graph-type structures have been used to model molecular form in subjects such as chemistry, which is another field where spectral analysis has played a very important role. Examples in computer science, we have structures such as the World Wide Web. We have organization of databases. We have scheduling applications, communication networks, which is a model using graph structures that dates right back to some of the early work in computer science in the late 1940s and 1950s. If we look at those forms, those graph structures, in terms of their adjacency matrices and the spectral properties of the matrices involved, then we have a number of significant results that are developed. There can be some complications that arise. So, for example, graph structures, if we think of the World Wide Web, for example, these are typically very often directed graphs rather than undirected graphs. And that can lead to problems with the presence of complex number eigenvalues. In practice, however, there are a number of ways of getting around these, of avoiding issues arising with complex eigenvalues. So, for example, some graphs are guaranteed only to have real eigenvalues. A typical example is the case of symmetric graphs, which really correspond to undirected graph structures. Others, the World Wide Web structure being one example, we're only interested in dominant eigenvalues, in the largest eigenvalue. And in the case of the World Wide Web, if we have an appropriate structure, that dominant eigenvalue is guaranteed to be a real number. Another approach, we can use manipulations such as taking the adjacency matrix and multiplying it by the transpose matrix, and that gives us a form which is symmetric and therefore only has real eigenvalues. That's an approach which we'll see is used in formulating this mechanism called singular value decomposition, which I'll be talking about in the next lecture. So, we have some quite famous graph theoretic results which derive from spectral analysis. So, for instance, if we take our graph, which is a set of nodes and a set of edges, we model it by some adjacency matrix. Then, if we let this denote the spectrum of the graph, this is in the standard ordering from largest eigenvalue to smallest eigenvalue, then what we find is the number of edges in that graph is exactly equal to the sum over all of the eigenvalues, the eigenvalue squared, that total sum divided by 2. So we don't even have to see the graph or be able to visualize the graph. We can calculate the number of edges in it simply by knowing its spectrum, by knowing the eigenvalues associated with the matrix. Coloring problems are very long history in algorithmic graph theory. So what is called the chromatic number, the number of colors needed properly to color the nodes of the graph? So in other words, in such a way that any two nodes which are linked are assigned a different color. That value, the chromatic number, that satisfies, it is at least the result on the left-hand side here. It is at most the largest eigenvalue plus one. So, typical sorts of questions you might see. Suppose you have an adjacency matrix with five nodes, and this has a spectrum of rounded eigenvalues given by that description on the slide. So you might be asked, given that information, how many edges does that graph contain? How many colors minimally are needed properly to color the nodes of that graph? How many colors at most are needed to properly color the nodes of that graph? And what we find, if we want to tackle that question, just to remind, to recap what the background is. So there's our graph spectrum. How many edges does that graph contain? Well, we sum up the squares. We sum up the squares of those values, and we found, allowing for arithmetic error, the total we get from those is very, very slightly over 14. We find that the rounded summation gives 14. We divide that by 2. And so the graph with this spectrum contains exactly 7 edges. What about the coloring problems? If we want to know how many colors minimally we have to use, we look at this computation, 1 minus this value, and that comes to 1 plus 1.3. We can't have a third of a color. In other words, that tells us the minimum number of colors we need for this 5-node graph is 3. What about the upper bound, the maximum number of colors? It's 1 plus the largest eigenvalue. This is the largest eigenvalue. We add 1 to that. We get this quantity here. Once again, we cannot have fractional colors, so that tells us we need at most 3 colors. We've already discovered we need at least 3 colors. So we have an exact bound on our chromatic number for this particular graph. Just to illustrate, the spectrum for that particular graph that was derived from the adjacency matrix of this structure. We need at least 3 colors because we have this triangle structure. We need at most 3 colors, as is illustrated in the diagram here. What about other properties of graph structures? First of all, we notice the way we have treated the spectrum there, we have ordered values according to their literal outcome. We're not using this absolute value convention, which we've typically applied when we have complex eigenvalues occurring. We don't use absolute value operations. Other properties we find, the relationship between the sum of squares of eigenvalues and the number of edges in a graph, that is just a special case of a property which is described in one of the tutorial questions. In particular, what we find is that the sum of the kth powers of eigenvalues of the adjacency matrix, when we divide that by k factorial, That describes the number of closed walks of length k in the graph. In other words, the number of ways of starting at a particular node and traveling back to that node when we use only k links to do so. So if we looked at the case where we are looking at closed walks of length 3, in other words, the number of triangles in the graph, then what we find is we sum up the cubes of the eigenvalues, we divide that by 6, and that tells us that the graph we were working with contains exactly 2 triangles. Now, there are problems with applying that to cases where we're looking at closed walks of length at least 4, and the problem is that our counting method includes degenerate cases. So one, such as we travel from a node to another node, we travel back to our starting point, and then we repeat that process. So if I look at our example graph, then here we have our exactly 2 triangles. This one marked A, traveling from 1 to 2 to 4 and back to 1. And this other triangle, which I've indicated is B, traveling from 1 to 2 to 3 and back to 1. And that particular graph, there are no other triangles present. So just to summarize what we've seen, coloring is only one of the graph properties where spectral analysis has provided some very useful insights. If we take the case of graphs which are bipartite, then that means the set of nodes in the graph can be split into 2 sets with no edges in the graph connecting nodes in one set to nodes in the same set, then the spectrum for that type of graphs has this kind of symmetry property. If we look at the eigenvalues, then the first half is exactly the negation of the second half. Other work that's gone on, and this is quite advanced work, has been used in what are called concentrators and superconcentrators. So these are special networks where we have a small number of links used to expand from the set of reachable nodes in one graph to the set of reachable nodes in another part of the graph. So spectral techniques and algorithmic graph theory, these are a traditional mechanism that has been used in analyzing graph structures. What I'm going to go on to in the next lecture is to look at other applications of spectral techniques, in particular in image analysis and compression, and in how Google has used spectral analysis in order to deal with web page ranking.